Boa noite.
Yeah, you speak a little bit Portuguese. We'll talk about about that in a while. Your work is very political. Do you believe that a song has the power to change someone?
I believe that our lives are founded in rhythm, you know, like the heartbeat and what have you. And I think that music plays an integral part in our understanding and our relationship to so many things. So that my answer is yes, but I don't know if I mean a singular song or if I mean just the power of music. Music brings about...
In general,
it's founded on harmony,
yeah.
You know? And so you can have people that disagree on so many things in life, but a song can make them nod their head yes
together.
To the same thing together. And music has that power to transcend boundaries, yes.
Yeah, you say that music is in the hands and in the hearts of people.
Yes.
So is that what makes it powerful, right?
Well, truly, we are what make it powerful.
Yeah.
Truly, yes.
But has that happened to you? Has a song played this very important role in changing your way or...
Not a singular song, but music in general has affected my worldview and my understanding of humanity, of cultures. As a kid growing up in the 80s in New York City, for example, in New York, and, you know, when hip-hop was being born, hip-hop in general helped me define myself as an African-American male, you know, so that it was the necessary voice of confidence that every young black, you know, person needed to know that even if, you know, racism was institutionalized, that we had every right to stand up and say, well, I don't care what you say. It taught me how to feel confident in questioning authority, you know, where 30 years before then, you know, people were lynched for just looking a white person in the eye. I never felt that fear. I never felt any of that fear. And music, hip-hop in particular, kind of gave me part of that backbone to stand up and be like, what? Yeah? That's what you think? So what? Here's what I think. So music can empower, certainly. And I've been empowered by music.
And you felt that in the 80s, as soon as hip-hop started?
Yeah. I felt it almost as if I had created it. You know, like the way that we had to defend it initially, which is the same thing that happens, you know, when a religion has been born in history or something. There's something that comes from having to defend something. When people be like, it's not even music, they're just talking, you know, and like, it is true music, you know. And then when hip-hop became, because at first it was just party music, but when it became politicized in the later 80s, then our parents, who used to be like, turn it down, were like, what did he say? Turn it up. And then we got to see how surprised they were that they would play something that said that on the radio, you know, because they would never do that in their time.
Yeah, that those messages could be said.
Exactly. Yeah, but we took it, of course, for granted.
I've read in an interview that as soon as hip-hop started, you felt the urge to rhyme.
Yeah. Yeah, the
even as a child.
Yeah,
you were about,
I started writing when
I was nine
yeah. years old. Yeah, there's a famous label in hip hop called Def Jam, you know, which everybody knows from Jay-Z and from LL Cool J to Public Enemy and all that. The first single that came out in Def Jam was produced by Rick Rubin, and it was a song called "It's Yours."
1981.
And before that song, hip hop had been more disco. You know, like, I said hip-hop, you know, it was more disco. And It's
Technotronic.
Yours. Yeah, Technotronic type of thing. And then when It's Yours came out, it was the first song that ever came out with what we call a breakbeat in hip-hop, which is just, and someone just talking over the beat. And I heard that as an 8 or 9 year old, and I was like, wow, big words. I want to do that. And I got a dictionary and stole a pad from my dad and started writing rhymes, you know, based on that. Of course, my first rhymes were what we would call braggadocio.
Do you remember them?
I remember some of them. What I'll say is this, is that they were, you know, they were all about how cool I am, and mm-hmm. this imagined world when I was, where I was the coolest person in the world. I'm the coolest guy that you've ever known, you know, like, you know, that sort of thing. It was all braggadocio.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm. And how do you look at hip-hop nowadays?
I think that, you know, well, one, hip-hop is global. You know, what I appreciate from hip-hop is the lesson in confidence that it has taught so many young people globally. What I also appreciate is the fact that hip-hop became global primarily through groups like Public Enemy, so that the first time that the world heard of hip-hop, they immediately thought of it as almost like, you know, music of the favelas, it was politicized. You know, they thought of it as a political type of music, whereas it didn't start politically. Like I said, it started as party music, and then it became that. But for the global perception, they thought, oh, this is what political. Poor people, yeah. disenfranchised people use to speak up about, you know, their problems and what have you. And so then seeing groups around the world popping up and always being politicized, I thought that was amazing. And then, of course, hip-hop transformed just like America transformed through Reaganomics, you know, like mm-hmm. everything transformed. And there was a time, you know, in recent history where hip-hop became almost like reflective of, you know, capitalist right-wing views of like, I don't want to talk to you if you don't have any money, you know, you know, that sort of thing. And of course, at that time, for me, it was difficult because it went from being this thing that helped me define who I am, where now it was this thing where I said, that's not who I am,
mm-hmm.
you know, so that it became important for us to expand the definition of hip-hop,
yeah.
so that it wasn't only this, you know, the music of the have-nots dreaming about all the stuff they could have.
And what defines hip-hop?
Well, I think what I would say is, you know, like, for instance, as someone who I started as a rapper, but then I matured into writing poetry, you know, and I think lots of rappers do that. But when I distinguish between hip hop and poetry, maybe I can best give a definition of hip hop through distinguishing
okay.
between what is the difference between yeah. hip hop and poetry.
Yeah, we'll talk about that later.
Cool. All right.
But the thing I ask you is, you have this political messages, and at the same time, you have these hip-hoppers that have been arrested for drugs, for crimes, and so on. Is there a contradiction between these two fields?
Well, the main thing is this, is that hip-hop is rhythm and voice, okay? We are all, like, in English, we would call ourselves persons. Person comes from Latin. Per means being, sun means sound, beings of sound. So that we are defined by our ability to vibrate sound,
mm-hmm.
okay? So that, and we are all beats and voices, you know, and hip-hop reflects that. It augments that. So that through hip-hop, you can really realize the power and the importance of words. You know, Tupac, for instance, said that he never had a criminal record until he said that he did on record. Or on a record.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? So that I believe and I've learned that things that we say, regardless of how much meaning we put into them or what have you, have a weight and a power of their own. They have the ability to manifest through the energy that we invest in them simply by saying them. And so when Biggie Smalls or Notorious B.I.G. names an album Ready to Die, he's not just saying that. He's projecting that into the universe so that it comes as no surprise to me after he names his second album, Life After Death, that he dies before it comes out. We have slang in America that's like word up.
Mm-hmm.
Word is bond. That's the, you know, the language of the streets. We say something like, oh, word up. Word is bond. And word is bond means what you say is going to happen. And we're not the first to figure that out. That comes from religion and our relationship to religion. That's why, you know, a priest would tell you to say 10 Hail Marys, because they know that by saying those things, there is a power through recitation and what have you. Well, hip-hop asks you to recite the lyrics with it, and you have to be careful of what you're reciting, because when you do, mm-hmm. there is a power, and
so
it
you have
can affect
to be,
you.
You have to be careful with the messages, so...
Not just with hip-hop, though.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, exactly.
But I mean, in general, with in
yeah.
poetry as well.
Yeah, in life, in small talk, in conversations, in thoughts.
Mm-hmm. You were talking about poetry. Acting, poetry, and music. In which area do you feel you belong the most?
Well, it's a hard question. Because I've spent so much of my life in school studying, I feel I've studied theater, and I spent the majority of my life studying theater. Through studying theater, I came to a very intense understanding of language and poetry and what have you, through breaking down writers like Shakespeare and what have you, the amount of time that we spend trying to figure out what they're saying. I came to an understanding of that, but my credentials are in acting. Hip-hop was never something I could study in school, but if it were something I could study in school, I wonder what they would credit me as, because I spend so much time studying it, you know, walking down the street and all this stuff. So I feel officially like I could say I'm an actor because I have credentials to be so. But music has always been in me, and poetry has always been there.
So going back to the difference between poetry mm-hmm. and hip-hop, and trying to define hip-hop,
yes.
What can you say now?
What I would say is this, is that, you know, hip-hop by nature is competitive. You know, you hear it all the time, rappers claiming to be the best rapper alive, and audiences not really want to listen to a rapper unless they claim to be the best one alive. And so hip-hop is like a gladiator sport. And so because of that, the rapper often takes on the stance of a warrior, where they feel that they can show no sign of vulnerability. So that, you know, there's a saying in America, another saying from the streets that's like, act like you know. Act like you know. And the MC in hip-hop kind of acts like he knows everything, even if he doesn't. Like, I know all about that. You can't tell me nothing, you know? A poet, on the other hand, realizes the power in admitting that they don't know, that they're still learning. So basically, a poet realizes the power of vulnerability, where a rapper oftentimes, this isn't true of every rapper, but the danger is that a rapper, because of the competitive nature of hip-hop, would forget the importance of admitting that they're still learning, that there's still room to grow.
And how do you mix both things?
I didn't make myself, and I'm not mixing both things. I see them as inevitably mixed. I'm just acknowledging that there's mix. I don't feel like...
But do you think there's a contradiction in there?
I think there's a... I think that
some
the biggest contradiction... Well, once again, if I were to look at the schizophrenia, I would have to look at... Because I think the issue of vulnerability and whether vulnerability is power is not rooted in hip-hop. If I were to root it in anything, I'd root it in patriarchal society and in our relationship to religion, for example, you know, where you have, this idea of the vulnerable being feminine and the feminine being weak because the feminine yields to temptation. And so because of that, you know, limited understanding, the idea that the feminine cannot be within the idea of the divine. So you get a holy trinity that is, you know, a common sense might tell you that a holy trinity would be mother, father, child. Uncommon sense might tell you that a trinity should be father, male, child, and ghost. To me, it's obvious that I'm not struck by lightning right now. You know, and I think that misconception, it's the same misconception where President Bush, after 9/11, got on TV immediately in America and said, we will show no sign of vulnerability. When I think of the progress of African
Americans... Was it a divine misconception?
I think it's a divine misconception. I think that we practice a misunderstanding of power, a misunderstanding of the feminine, and thus a misunderstanding of self. And so I think that hip-hop simply reflects that in the same way that I see church and society reflects that. Hip-hop is just a reflection.